What's up? Welcome to Happy Hour. Today we have Deffer. This is going to be really cool because Deffer and I grew up together. Probably one of my oldest graffiti friends. Met at Pan Pacific through a fence.
Yeah, through a fence,
through
right?
Through a fence. But yeah, so we're going to talk about a lot of shit. There's so much to talk about. I don't know where we're going to start. You know, we're unformatted, unscripted. We got no plan again. But Deffer and I always seem to be able to talk for hours, so it's not going to be a problem. I don't know, fuck, where should we start? There's so much shit.
Why don't we start in the beginning, man? Pan Pacific.
Let's do it. So I remember Pan Pacific. I remember you walking up and you said you had a book.
Yeah.
Check out my book. And we talked. And we talked like over the couple weeks.
Yeah,
we talked through the fence.
Yeah, because
like I was like locked inside and like people locked outside. And, like it was like a weird thing. And then we met and then we, you know, we kind of traveled simultaneously through the beginning, you know, through all the, you know, Radiotron and all this different shit. And then, you know, we got in these crews, the first real crews, really, you know, for West Coast, you know.
West Coast,
The first monster crews, K2S and WCA.
Yeah.
And then we're rivals and then remained friends somehow through all this shit. And, yeah, here we are.
Here we are. Yeah. It's kind of like a friendly hip-hop rivalry, 100%. You know, because
it was
all
dope.
About battling. And if
it was,
it wasn't
was
about,
so dope back then.
Yeah, it was about enhancing your skills and whatnot more. Yeah. On the context of breaking through in the artistic format or whatever you did. If it was like you breakdance, you battled another crew, but there was no, it was like sports.
Yeah.
You had the Boston Celtics, Lakers, whatnot, you know,
like-minded
what I mean?
Individuals, you know, like-minded, we respected each other.
Yeah.
And we pushed each other.
Yeah.
That's, you know, the whole battling thing. That's what that was about.
Yeah.
You know, good times.
Good times, man.
Let's talk. I mean, so
Belmont Tunnel. Yeah.
Man. That place has so much history, and that was like really a humbling place for me because that was their spot. You know, they owned that spot. We owned the Motor Yard, we owned West Coast Tracks, but Belmont was their spot, and I used to go there, and it was my favorite spot to paint. So it was really awkward for me. You know,
it was a hairy spot just in general, though. I mean, there was always an element of danger there lurking.
100%.
So I mean, there was always that. You know, it wasn't just our spot, but it was a place where things could go really bad really quick.
Really quick.
You know, so
real quick.
Yeah, so it was, and you know, if you're in there, you're trapped in there.
You're trapped, and it was an intersection for a lot of neighborhoods, right?
Exactly,
so you had
Diamond Street up above, Headhunters.
Diamond Street, Magician Clubs, Rockwood.
Yeah, everybody, yeah.
18, but there was everybody right there, right?
Yeah, it was like a cross section, so, and it was a dead zone too, so to speak. So, you know, it was one of those places in the early 80s, you know, wasn't a safe place to be.
No.
And you never knew what was going to happen, because if you were in there, the cops could decide to raid or anything. You just, it was a lot of uncertainty.
A lot of uncertainty.
And a lot of mystery, too.
A lot of mystery. And people used to shoot down in there. Like, dude, they shot at us so many times, man. I used to go to Belmont at night in the beginning, before it was legal, you know. I was painting there at night and shit. And they'd go from the bridge and shoot down on us.
Yeah.
And then I saw some crazy-ass shit there, man.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Dream. Dream, you know, RIP Dream. I think me and Dream probably were there every weekend of our life, you know, like in those formidable years. Speaking of Belmont, music that we listened to back in the day.
Man, you know, like it was crazy because graffiti, you know, maybe it's, they'd categorize it as like maybe hip hop or the black sheep element, the fifth element or whatever.
Yeah.
So it was always the bastardized child, right?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So no matter what, that's one thing about graffiti. Music, it transcended hip hop. Like I was in a punk rock back then.
Yeah.
You know, Olympic Auditorium gigs in the 80s.
Yeah.
You know, after Olympic got banned, we went to Fender's Ballroom.
Right.
You know what I mean? So you got the dudes from the West Side. They listened to Suicidal Tendencies.
That was it. I was from Venice, you know, so it was all about Suicide. It was all punk rock.
Yeah, Rim Pest, XL,
Beowulf,
the Beer Nuts.
The Beer Nuts.
Yeah, I'm telling you,
bro. I was Cajun from the Beer Nuts.
Yeah, so there was a lot of different elements to it. So graffiti always transcended music and style. You could rock with a dude, you know, that was into punk rock. You know,
you know what's dope about that? Because LA graffiti started getting like this aggressive nature, right?
Yeah.
And the letters were sharper, aggressive.
Exactly.
The characters were meaner, and you know, had these big crazy mouths and shit. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a punk rock influence of the West Coast.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
And
exactly.
You know, we developed. I think we're the first place to develop a different style than New York style, because Europe had the New York style. Everyone had the New York style, because you know they had been in there. They're fucking awesome. I love that shit. I was raised on that. But LA, I think, was the first place to make their own style.
But the thing was, like, now. You can go on the internet and you can go to Paris and see what Paris is doing. You can see what France is doing. You could follow a graffiti writer from Mexico and see what they're doing.
Yeah.
Back then, it was all by photos.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody went to New York. Yeah, if someone went to New York and they came back with an album, they were the shit.
And to get those negatives?
Yeah, negatives.
Being skeptical of the negatives?
Yeah.
We're fucking like, you know, that
That's
shit
what I'm saying. So that shit was gold back then. But yeah. now it's a dime a dozen.
Dime a dozen.
I mean, before we used to have to rack. Remember tester tips from the model cans, the
of
little
course.
Model cans?
Yeah.
We'd
yeah.
go in there and then we'd yeah. re-rack those.
Yeah.
And you guys came out with that.
Yeah. Well, they were doing, you know, West from FC
yeah, yeah. Uh-huh.
showed us what's up with that. You know? Mm-hmm. Soon knew about the tester caps and yeah, yeah. and all that shit. But West came out and goes, no, get Grumbacher. Get the okay, spray yeah, fixes. Yeah, yeah, that was yeah. the best cap.
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah,
I was
yeah.
like, there's a better cap than a tester? He's like, yeah,
yeah, yeah.
man.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, cool. And he just put us on game and then that was it, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Jeez.
But our graffiti got so, and ours in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
You know, came to us, all of us got so crisp.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was the thing. And I remember you guys, when you guys started, you especially, that big blocky style with those fucking sharp ass lines.
So it was like,
and people from around the world, by the time they saw it, were like, what the fuck is this?
But to tell the truth, man, that was an actual weakness.
Yeah.
Because I didn't have the can control of you or cry, you know,
yeah.
Rick.
Yeah, yeah, Rick.
You guys had those.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't have that same can control, so I had to, you know, compensate for, like, blocky letters.
Yeah.
But at that same time, it looked innovative.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it didn't look like anything else.
Yeah.
But it was also, I had a harder time, you know, because we didn't have, for lack of resources and can control.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, we had Krylons, remember?
Yeah.
Krylons and you know, it's high pressure.
Yeah.
Who would ever thought they would have cans made for graffiti?
Yeah, by graffiti artists.
Yeah, you know, that's like, crazy shit.
And look how many fucking colors.
That's what I'm saying. It's crazy, man.
And thank you to Montana Cans, my sponsor. Love you guys. Mm-hmm. They sponsor me since forever, and I love you. And they always keep me in paint. But yeah, I would never fucking have thought that they have 400 colors.
Yeah,
and like,
you would never.
You know, we had like 12 colors that we worked with. We had 12 colors that were our go-to.
Yeah.
And I don't know, man. It's kind of crazy. I remember when I saw that they did these can suppressors and all this shit so the magnets doesn't rattle in the yards
and shit.
And I was like blown away. I was what the fuck?
I mean, that's beyond comprehension because, you know, back when we started, there was no such thing as commission jobs.
Nope.
No, and there was no such thing as making money off of graffiti. It was actually, you went to jail for doing graffiti.
Yeah.
You got your ass whooped for doing graffiti. It was always a sacrifice.
Yeah.
There was no compensation.
Yeah.
It was basically basically, you were going to suffer the consequences if you did graffiti.
Yeah.
If you did breakdancing, you had a battle, people applauded, and you were known. But in graffiti, you were incognito.
Yeah.
You didn't want, people be like, I'm Risk. You know, that's Risk right there.
Yeah.
But you're actually Risk. So it was always a alter ego.
But also what was cool is like, we didn't have a Vandal Squad yet, right? So they didn't, they weren't hip on it, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I was a little retarded. I was like, I was like, I got a pager. And I started putting, for graffiti art page, this number.
Yeah.
I remember calling the number, like, who's this? Well, and I'd drive by and look and just make sure it wasn't cops. And I started getting jobs like that. But, like, it was a wild, wild west of graffiti back then, you know?
But you was a trip, man. You were the first, like, graffiti writer I saw on Eyewitness News.
Yeah.
No, it was INLA.
INLA,
that 30-minute show. Yeah, huh. Fucking.
Yeah.
It was a 30-minute show.
Yeah.
And you know, when I seen Risky, I was like, "What the fuck? That piece killed, dude."
Yeah.
I was like, but you were like, you know, I'm a business major and a graffiti, whatever minor business minor graffiti major type shit. I was like, damn, this dude's taking it another level.
Yeah.
So Risky was the one that took that shit to a rock star level.
I dedicate my life to it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But to actually come from something that was underground to above ground and to actually, you know, I guess monetize things, get things on the news and whatnot, and then, you know, it evolved from there. But you were the genesis in Los Angeles.
Thank you, I appreciate that. But my whole mission was to make graffiti a household name
and a
household genre.
Yeah.
I wanted our art form to be a real art form and not a bunch of kids. I was so offended when the city came and said, all right, we all applied for grants to do murals on the freeways and shit, right? I think it was like Olympics in 84, whatever it was. And they're like, cool. And there's a lot of graffiti artists that applied, and they go, why don't you guys just paint together and do one mural? And I was like, why the fuck? Picasso won't paint with Rembrandt.
Why
you put us all together? Oh, we're just a bunch of kids.
Yeah.
And I was on a mission. I was like, fuck that. Ever since then, I was like, fuck that, fuck them. We're going to have our own genre, our own art form, and we're going to take this shit over. And if you look at what's happening now, some of the biggest contemporary artists were taking shit over.
Yeah.
And I'm not there yet, but I'm trying to be like some of you guys. But it's going to be dope as fuck. And I dedicate my life to this art form being a real art form. And it is now.
It is now. Yeah.
It's crazy, man. I rode that fucking roller coaster like a motherfucker, bro. Yeah. I rode that motherfucker until I was arrested in jail, in and out of jail. Like, people praised me, people hated me. I rode that roller coaster until the wheels fell off, you know? And I don't know where it's going now, but it's been fun so far.
Yeah. That's one thing about art in general, but especially art form of art, it's consistently inconsistent.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You got to ride with the tide, and it's crazy. It's always a dip into the unknown.
Yeah.
It's always unknown. You know what I mean? So, because we did it for passion, not for money.
Yeah.
And everything back then was about consequence. You were going to get caught. A hood could catch you, smoke
you're
gonna
get you, your ass kicked.
Whatever. You're going to get your ass kicked.
And, you know,
back then the cops would spray paint on your face and drop you off in someone's hood.
Oh,
and
man,
say,
they spray paint me
motherfucker.
Silver. Yeah. They made me, you know, they'd catch me writing, you know, suicidal in Venice, like gang shit in Venice, and make me tag my homies.
Yeah.
Like, you know, just fucked up shit. And like now we can laugh about it, but back then it was like fucked up, you know?
Yeah, but it was like those instances could have went either way to where you could have been killed.
Yeah, 100%.
You could not be here. I would not be here. You know, we're blessed and highly favored that we are here.
100%, bro. You know, I've been shot,
you know,
stabbed, and I'm very lucky.
Yeah.
And, you know, back then I was a little young, and I was like kind of naive maybe.
Yeah, exactly.
And I thought that shit was kind of cool. Now with four daughters, I'm like, fuck that shit, man.
Yeah,
like,
it's not worth it.
It ain't worth it. Plus, you know, you just get to a elevated place in life where you're more thankful. And you want to give back, and it's just... life changes. And look, I'm doing all this bright shit. You know, my graffiti was usually dark and this now.
It was always dark.
You know, from anarch to monarch, you know.
Yeah.
You know, like, so that's what it's about. And if you look around, like, we never really thought we'd ever have, like, you know, me and you, I don't think thought we'd be sitting 40 years later or some shit in Thousand Oaks.
Yeah, exactly.
With my four daughters running around, some chickens and, you know. Like,
yeah.
But,
exactly. So it's definitely like, you know, I see the metamorphosis of a butterfly, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because it's this thing that evolves from a caterpillar and becomes this thing that you know. And it's crazy.
Oh, you know, so check it out. So the boys from Metallica sent us over this.
Oh shit.
I thought that's pretty dope. So I mean that's an accomplishment too.
Fuck yeah.
To have them send us over this for our happy hour.
Cool.
That's pretty cool. So this is their Blackened American Whiskey. And the boys from Metallica sent it for me and Dad for us to drink it. I don't know if we'll drink it all right now, but by the end of the night...
we'll drink most of it.
Like, most of it. And it's dope. Some records.
Yeah, I get goosebumps when I hear Metallica, because it's just so... it was like the soundtrack of our life back then,
right?
You know? Ride the Lightning. That was graffiti. Fucking Ride the Lightning. You know what I mean?
And
it's prophetic too, man.
Yeah.
You know, all the traveling, wherever I may roam.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And
it was just so driving.
Yeah, yeah. And I think James Hetfield said some kind of like quote where it was like, there was a point in my career where I wanted to do like a movie, I wanted to do this, but I realized I was motherfucking Metallica. You know what I mean? And so it ran through his veins, and we're motherfucking graffiti.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So that's the way I see it.
And they have them send us this?
Damn, bro.
We made it.
We made it.
We could die.
We could die now. Kill me. Kill me now. Got Metallica
you know,
here.
Lars has an incredible collection, right? I think he has a collaboration piece I did with Kuz.
Yeah.
He doesn't have my personal stuff yet, or Deffers, so what's up?
Yeah, what's up? Yeah.
But we appreciate this. Thank you, guys.
Let's take a shot.
Yeah, let's take a shot. All right, get some glasses.
Dang, Metallica, dude. Jeez.
Right?
Damn, man. I mean, that stuff... I mean, their music means so much to me, you know, in terms of, you know, like, just the message, man, master of puppets.
Yeah.
Where it's almost like COVID shit, where masters of puppets
so
pulling
project,
our strings.
Bro. I'm doing this project with Muggs is going to produce it. And I want to get a graffiti artist and a musician together, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And everyone does their own song.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, I want to do, like, you know, I'm Your Puppet, but, like, death rock. I'm Your Puppet! Like, you know, that kind of thing, right? And we hook up one artist with one musician.
Yeah.
Travis Barker's down, Everlast. Mm-hmm. All these people are down, so you got to get down with it.
Yeah. Let me know.
Music, Belmont Tunnel, Rock the Bells, that was my go-to. I'm bringing it up because another ultimate dream and goal of mine was LL came to me and gave me a little piece of Rock the Bells station. I'm the graffiti ambassador for the station.
Yeah.
Love you guys. And so I thought we'd do Rock the Bells on this canvas and give it to someone or auction or do something, you know, whatever.
Exactly.
Give it to charity, who cares? But I know that that meaning has something to you too that I want to talk about.
Yeah, like it has a Rock the Bells has a very personal meaning because, you know, during the early days of hip hop, right? Yeah. You know, like, you know, you had words that are irrelevant now, like fresh.
Yeah.
Death, that's death. Nobody uses that no more. I think Method Man said that in like 90, like those words are non-existent. I don't say it, but anyways, but
like, that's just death.
But the thing is, like, you know, those were words back then. It was so kind of like maybe so basic, like to have a name like Def. But so I added Defer, but I had a Def Jam hat, you know, and back then it was like, you know, Cool J was like one of my favorites back then, my personal favorites, and you know, Rock the Bells.
Rock the
you
Bells know what I mean? And Radio. Radio Inside My Hand.
Yeah, like all shit. That. You know what I mean? But even I like Round the Way Girl, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I need a girl with extensions in her hair, bamboo earrings, at least two pairs, a Fendi bag and a bad attitude.
Yeah.
You know, because it was on some cool stuff, you know what I mean? And it was like, you know, I'm going back to Cali. And they played that on Lesson Zero. Remember Lesson Zero?
Oh, man, that shit.
They played that on Lesson Zero. Who knows about that? You got to be old cats like us.
Lesson Zero was, dude, that shit.
Right? Yeah, you know what I mean?
Remember those clubs, those underground clubs in Lesson Zero?
Yeah, I'm telling you, bro.
Going to those clubs, really, like downtown.
And this guy was he was a rock star back then, you know what I mean? So he went to the clubs. I was trying to sneak in, though, you know?
I snuck in, still.
Yeah.
I thought we'd do Rock the Bells.
Let's do it.
Just kind of, you know, you freak it and I'll throw paint on it. We'll just go back and forth and see where it goes. You know.
And I did meet Cool J finally after all these generations at Beyond the Streets.
Yeah, he was Roger. Cool as fuck,
you know,
right?
What's up? Yeah.
I was there that night. He was cool as fuck.
Yeah, he was cool as fuck. Straight up.
Are we going to sip this like gentlemen?
We're violent gentlemen. Just take a shot. Let's do a Metallica shot, you know what I mean? All right, cheers. Graffiti isn't gentleman-like, so sorry. Ooh, wee.
Pretty good.
Yeah, it's smooth.
You guys want a shot?
Yeah.
What made you pick up the brush?
Man, you know what it was, man? you know, I initially, a couple places hit me up to do some works in a show, right? And I was living in this, you know, little apartment in Sherman Oaks. And we had a balcony. And I was trying to, like, do something on canvas.
I was in Sherman Oaks at one time.
Yeah, I mean, I was trying to do something on a micro level, but trying to incorporate. So I used spray paint and decos. But, man, I mean, living in an apartment in Sherman Oaks. And then, you know, when you took the painting into the house, it would smell.
Right.
So I had to shut it down for, you know, those reasons, right? So... And then, you know, picking up the brush isn't something that, you know, is just, you know what I'm saying? It takes a little time to get used to. So, you know, because spray paint, we usually get that one hit quit, you know,
right.
we're able to cover everything in one hit. But the way I was trying to do canvases, I started using brush just out of necessity because where I lived and, you know, just you know, I didn't have a big space. I lived in an apartment. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so I kind of used it out of necessity instead of choice, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, as I kept progressing, I kind of, I found spirituality in the brush, man.
Like meditation kind of?
Meditation, yeah. It became a meditative process.
Yeah.
And it was almost like, you know, because graffiti is so can control centric and everything. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, but doing smaller works and stuff like that, I was able to hone the brush and I found that it would give me tranquility, you know what I'm saying? While I was using the brush. And then I found out too, like, you know, it was almost taking another route, right? And I wanted to master the usage of the brush. And also, there was a lot of historical context behind the brush, you know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
And the pen.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Even the pen is mightier than the sword, right?
Right.
You know, pen could enact wars. So it was a mental and spiritual thing. So as I evolved, I had a context behind using it and a freedom and a flow, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, and you know, we're true graffiti writers. If it's on a canvas, it ain't really graffiti. It has roots, but it's not really graffiti. You know what I mean? Because if we're not on the streets doing it without anybody's permission, then it's graff. You know what I mean? But, you know, We still go out there once in a while, because of the adrenaline.
I think it might have happened once or twice recently.
Yeah, maybe sort of. But, obviously, you get older, and who knew, man? Thanks to Risky, guys like, Risky, he made the business model, you know what I'm saying?
Hey, below poverty level says you're one of the best Rush artists in the world. Salute.
Thank you, man. Happy birthday. I tried to make it to your birthday, bro.
I did too. He did it on fucking happy hour though, bro.
Yeah, but I mean, it was all the way in Newport Beach or some shit, and I was late as fuck.
Yeah, he's like, let's do it on boat. I said, I can't. We already have it. Is it? Ah, really? Let's say what's up to Casey.
Casey, what's up? My brother.
My brother. Happy birthday. I didn't know it's your birthday, but now I know it's your birthday. I love you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Casey.
Triple OG, Casey. Big Eclipse.
Yeah, man. Some of your letter influences. With the brush, letter form influences.
Letter form influences, man. It's crazy because it's like, I think mine's is a hybrid. I mean, obviously you see like old English, right? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so some of it is based off of, and then you see a little bit of neighborhood stuff in there, right? So it's a little bit of this, a little bit of that. You know what I mean? I think the first person to master the brush is the Godfather Chaz, right? You know what I mean?
Yeah, man. That guy is like, I couldn't be more proud to be from LA because of that dude, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you got to give him supreme respect, you know what I mean? And he's always been like, you know, father figure, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, so with that being said, as far as letters though, it's kind of crazy because, this is structured letters, but, after the structured letters, I came out with spiritual language, you know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Which is, it's obliterating the letter form because all letters are structured, right? But spiritual language is, say, equated to the visual context of speaking in tongues. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So this is not spiritual language right here, but when I do spiritual language, it's basically speaking in tongues. It's
Well, it's also build and destroy, right?
So yeah, you take the letter, destroy, you destroy it. I do layer. Yeah, it's obliterating the letter form. Because wild style is basically taking the structure but contorting it,
right.
Adding, arrows, loops, chips, you know what I mean? Whatever you're going to call them, you know what I mean? But, spiritual language is basically automatic painting. So it would almost be categorized as gestural abstract.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So,
Yeah,
it's all good. Fuck it.
Goes with the territory. We're right here, though.
We're right here.
Curry Gee says Buster from Mexico will take all you guys out like whiteout.
Who said that? Who said that?
Curry.
Who?
Curry Gee.
It's all good. Buster's from my crew. Buster's from K2S. He's my teammate. So
I don't know if you know that.
Yeah, he's Buster's from K2S. I love Buster.
Is he good? I haven't seen his shit.
He's good.
Yeah. Buster is a buster. Oh, come on. Here you guys go. Gang banging now. Here we go.
Can they do this, though? You know what I mean?
Talking about deconstruction, I don't know if you know this, but see, cartoon always told me about weights and balances of letters, right?
Yeah.
So all my letters look like they're either like fighting or dancing. And they're all repetition. So when I do these circles and lines, the horizontal and vertical lines are the letter form. And the circles are the most rudimentary form of the graffiti. Right? It's the cloud background or the bubble fill-in. So that's my deconstruction. So that's why people always, what's up with the lines and circles? And that's what it is. So that's my graffiti.
Yeah, I think it's just so many years we put in, right?
Yeah.
And graffiti was always about pushing it to another level. You know what I'm saying? In terms of evolving, right?
Yeah.
It was like, one of the best pieces I've ever seen in my life was when you and Slick did the Ice Cube video.
Yeah, it was a dope piece.
And you
bro.
Did that Risky piece, bro. Yeah. I was like, game over. I quit. I'm gonna join the gang or something. You know what I mean?
You know what's funny about that piece?
Yeah.
If you look at what I'm doing now, all this water shit.
Yeah.
That was the first time I ever did that shit.
But that was the first piece that I've ever saw where you it was rendered. It was sliced up and down. It was sliced up and down. And every, man, that shit was intimidating.
But it's funny because look at, you know, where you're at and where you came from. And like that, that was the first piece I did the fucking, all the water and the drip shit I'm doing, you know?
Yeah, but that piece, I mean, it was like one of those moments that you captured in time that just fucked people up in L.A., you know what I mean?
Yeah, he's like, why is my name running like that? Like,
yeah, but I mean, that piece right there was like, you know, basically groundbreaking. It set the tone for Los Angeles style, but, you know, within the context of graph.
Yeah.
You know, with can control, with the colors. I mean, basically, you caught thunder in a bottle.
Yeah,
that's what it is, right? You caught thunder in a bottle.
Dude, we gotta do some of that. Thunder in a bottle, that's dope.
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's when you catch that shit, and that's what I call a defining moment, right? You know what I mean? When you
Travis brought some of that.
Huh?
He brought a bottle of that one night.
Oh, Travis Walker brought us some moonshine.
Who? Travis Barker?
Travis Walker.
A Walker. Okay.
That's thunder in a bottle.
Okay. Yeah. Moonshine. I ain't fucking with that, but.
So I don't know what we can do with this, but we're going to give it away or something for charity or something, right? What do you think?
Whatever happens, man. It's, I think right now with
unless Al calls and wants it, we got to give it to him.
Yeah, we give it to him.
We got to give it to him.
Okay. But you know, you always got to give props to the pioneers because, you know, they were the soundtrack of our lives
right.
at that time. You know what I mean? You know, and, I always admired Cool J too. Because Cool J, you know, he boxes, he invests in Wall Street. He was always...
The best rap battle to me was him and Kumo D.
I go to work.
Oh, my God, bro. I waited days for the rebuttals. Like, I just waited for, like, the next song.
Yeah, that was a defining moment.
Took those
moment.
L's and rocked your bells. Like, hit me.
Exactly.
Kumo D had some good ones.
Yeah, Kumo D was, you know, I mean, I go to work like a boxer, right?
Yeah.
And he did good. But, you know, one thing about Cool J, he was always a savage, you know what I mean? So
take a drink. Yeah. Oh, by the way, I gotta talk about Sticky Babes.
Yeah, what's up?
So I curate for them as well as I got a pin, right?
Yeah.
And I wanna get you a pin deal with them to do a pin. Do you have anything going with that?
No, let me know. Right,
we'll
let's do it. Let's
I'll
do
talk
it.
To you off air, but yeah, we'll get you a pin.
Yeah, let's do
It'd
it.
Be dope. Do we have any sticky vape pins anywhere? Anybody have any of the wrist sticky vape pins?
I have about five of them.
Does anyone have one of the wrist sticky vape pins? Here, let me run next door and grab one.
Go to store?
Let me run next door and grab one.
Who?
Dana.
What up, Dana? What's up?
It's
always a soul assassin thing.
Always.
Always.
Flex, what's up?
What up, Flex? Much love, brother. OG right there. LA original. Notorious ones.
Awesome, Mike.
Who are we doing here? Jumping here, brother.
There you go.
Rock the bells.
You're up.
So this is the pin, right? So.
Okay.
So you'll do your packaging, whatever. We'll do a pin. Tell me about some of your collabs. You did a bunch of dope collabs.
Yeah, I've done pretty much everything with everybody, right?
Right.
In terms of major companies. Yeah. Yeah.
What's some of the highlights?
I love the project with Beats by Dre.
Those were shout fucking
out
fire.
Shout out to Casey Ryder, Jay White, and the rest of the crew.
I need some of those, by the way.
Yeah, but it was real. Yeah, they weren't even for sale, but shout out, you know, but I believe in manifesting.
Right.
You know, because we have no control of where our art goes.
Right.
We could only control our work ethic.
You're very spiritual, right? And I know you do MMA, whatever. So did that help you? Because I know you're, we can talk about when you're younger. Defra was kind of crazy.
Yeah, a little.
Defra's a little off. So
a little off.
He was a terror in the streets. So what got you grounded?
You know, I think a lot of age, because, you know, back in the day, you know, I think a lot of things weren't by choice. It was by survival.
Right.
You know, if you grew up on this block, you had to represent this block. And you know, I've always been the underdog, whether I was, you know, outnumbered, outgunned, whatever. So, you know, every neighborhood I grew up in, I was an outlier. You know, I was a one-on-one. So I had to survive some harsh circumstances, but, you know, it's like a beautiful struggle, though.
Right.
You know, and you know, I think now it's a different world.
100%.
You know, back then, you know, we didn't have Instagram.
No.
If I was going to check out a risky piece, you jump on the 31 bus, take it to Pico, get off on Western, jump this gate, hop that gate. Yeah. There's two dogs there.
Yeah.
They're barking. But throw two treats over there, go around this way, dude's name Pablo on this block, and then bam, bam, bam.
Yeah.
It was a mission.
Yeah.
You didn't have GPS. We had, Thomas Guide or something?
Thomas Guide.
And then we had bus schedules, right?
I was like,
we had bus schedules?
Yeah.
I mean, we used to throw the bus passes out to each other. Like, Gio will wait on one thing, and I'll throw the bus pass out. He'll run to the next
stop. What about riding the back of the buses?
All that. We used to ride on the grill, the grill gate, all that. So it was weird, because there was a weird, like, you know, you see kids with, like, iPhones and everything, and this, that, and the third. Back then, we used to have to rack everything.
Well, everything that was a sport, right?
It was a sport, but at some point, there was an element of poverty.
Yeah.
I used to do, like, chores, but they give me a dollar a week. It's like, where's the dollar going to just like, four Pac-Man games or something, right? You know what I mean? So,
racking, bro. So, you know, soon, I don't like, you know, me, I don't like you, you're an asshole. But that dude taught me so much, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But he taught me racking was part of the sport of graffiti.
Yeah.
We racked all day long and painted all night, you know?
Yeah.
I was part of it, man. It was good shit.
I mean, that was part of the protocol back then because, you know, everything was... Dan Dino is in the house. You got to get my boy. Oh, shit. You got to get my boy on film right here. Sorry about that. Imperfect. Dan Dino, what's up? We're live. It's my boy right here. Wes Grom.
What's happening?
In the house.
Good.
I've been going live with Dan Dino.
I went live. Oh, dude, remember that night we went live?
Yeah, we went live. But everybody that I know is like, where's Dan at? Where's Dan? I'll get him live right now. Dan's right here. Dan the man. Yeah. Yeah, we'll take the shot, because Dan's here.
Yeah.
All right.
So, I don't have a tattoo machine, but we got to do the WCA K2S tattoo.
Yeah, let's do it. You got me, I got you, right?
All
right,
cool. You're officially in WCA.
You're officially in K2S, bro. That's like, you got it. That's rivalry shit.
They don't even know what that is right there.
That's some shit like.
that just happened.
That's like a blood joining a Crip gang or some crazy. You know what I mean?
That's blood in blood.
It's unprecedented. But, you know, it's 2020. We're doing crazy shit now. The gloves are off in 2020.
COVID got crazy.
Yeah.
We lost our minds.
We lost our minds. So, so we're just...
His phone's going to blow up in a minute. My phone's going to blow up in a minute.
That's all good. Yeah, it's all good. We're taking all comers, though. You know what I mean? Because I got Dan Dino here, so it's all good. Hey, Metallica shots. You got... Hey, bro. Get the shot, dude. You got to do it righteous.
My bad.
There we go. Oh, man.
Ah, good. Pretty smooth though, right?
Yeah, that's really good.
Right? let's talk about some of the some of the people we grew up with. How's Prime doing? How's Rick doing? Rick was a huge influence to me. Rick was a dude that got me nervous because he had three of my letters. So I was like, oh, this motherfucker. You know, how's he doing?
I haven't seen Rick in a while. I mean, you know, obviously, you know, he's doing what, you know, he's living. We're all older at this time. You know what I mean?
And he still, does he still paint?
I don't know if he still paints. I can't really, like, you
this
know,
dude
I really
was a beast. If you guys don't know who Rick was, he was a fucking beast. That dude, and he was the epitome of graffiti, illegal graffiti, down Beverly, down what, all the way to Belmont Tunnel, from our yard to their yard. He made it known that he was there. Illegal pieces, garage doors, anything. Boom, boom,
anything,
boom.
Anything and everything,
Love him. Prime, obviously, I love. I haven't seen him in a while. Who else? Risco.
Risco, rest in peace. Man.
Risco, rest in peace. I met him very briefly, and he died. He wrote Risco. R-I-S-C-O-E. It was a piece I saw. It was dope as fuck.
Gio. Gio. Rest in peace. Sign, rest in peace. Love you. Sign loved you.
Gio did too. Me and Gio and Sign were probably the first connection with the whole K2S thing, whatever. Because we were like this. Because I'd show up at the fucking Belmont. I was there for the day. I'd show up in the morning. I had a 40 ouncer. I had a sandwich, and I was like there. And I'd hang out with those dudes forever. And then I met Skept, and then I knew you, and like whatever. But those dudes were fucking solid as a motherfucker. I got some photos I want to give you. They're dope. It's like me, Gio, and Sign. Leaning against the wall. And I think it's Handu and Shandu piece or something.
See, that's some history right there, man. That's crazy. Think about how long ago that was, and how things have changed. And you know, it's man. I just want to thank you, bro, because you definitely, you know, you made our art form a way for us to eat. You know what I mean?
And I couldn't have done it without the support system of everyone I know.
Exactly.
Including you. And it needed rivalries, healthy rivalries. It needed healthy artists. It needed aggressive artists. It needed artists that were fucking dope as fuck. It needed artists with a vision. And from the day I fucking met you, when you gave me the book Between the Fence, I was like, what the fuck's this? Because I was all about New York shit. And his shit was on. I was like, what is this? And now I see what it is. But, respect you.
Respect. A lot. Much love.
Love you.
You guys need a hug.
But it was crazy when you and Slick had Aerosolics.
Oh, man.
You guys went. Like, they traveled before anybody could travel.
Hey, what about the bunker in Hawaii?
Hey, the bunker in Hawaii all day. That was a beautiful thing. Hey, my boy Estevan had a 100-pound knapsack. We hiked it up there. Shout out to Miss Blue Queen and my boy Sean. We hiked it up there.
Estevan didn't show up?
Stefan's in downtown or something. But the bunker, beautiful. North Shore. Love it. You take the hike and then, you know, you suffer and then you paint. So it was all good.
Shout out to my boy Nick.
Huh?
What made you move to Hawaii?
Well, you know, obviously I was married and stuff like that. So, you know, my former wife's family had some health issues and stuff like that. And
you still go out there?
Huh?
Do you still go there?
Yeah. I got my dog out there, but he's gonna come back.
Yeah. What kind of dog?
His name is Buddy, and he's a half German Shepherd, half Black Lab.
That's my
ride or die right there.
Right.
I'll take a bullet for Buddy for sure.
You'll take a bullet for me though.
I will.
I'll take a bullet for you.
I will.
We take bullets for a lot of people.
We take bullets.
Like.
Yeah. But I love Hawaii. You know the vibe. Shout out to the Boar's Nest, the Nest in Maui. All my boys, my cousin Garen, motherfucking Kyborg.
I met some of your boys in Hawaii. Some of his boys in Hawaii are a little there.
We got squad out there.
Monster of Draw says hola.
Who?
Hola. Yeah, what's Monster up? Monster of Draw. What's up, hola? My boy. Yeah.
All right, Risky, you gonna paint any on this thing or no?
Yeah. You guys talk. I don't know what I'm gonna do.
All right, you got any shout outs you
want to
do?
Shout out to everybody, really. You know, everybody that supported, you know, everything we do. And like I say, whoever bought a mask or anything, because I don't really release product. I just do things that I would wear and I put out at a limited thing. So they're collector's items. We're closing the shop. And that's it. People wanted stuff to buy. It's going to be it in a week. Basically, my boy Big Sleeps, my crew K2S, you know, we're out there defending paloteros and aloteros, and we're out there, you know.
You guys are buying them out all the time?
We're buying them out. We're trying to do, you know, because there's so many. But like I said, you know, whatever money I, because like right now, I don't really care about money per se because I lost a lot of money already, but I'm willing to give.
Again?
No, I ain't. I'm good, though.
I lose
I'm
money. Good. Every day I lose money.
Yeah, we lose money.
We'll talk about this off air.
We'll talk about this off air. But the thing is, I know that life is, you know, it's about what you leave behind. You know what I mean? And as a graffiti writer, original, I could do without. You know what I mean? Because it's about moments. You know, and
us doing without is like way better than what we had before.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So we're blessed and highly favored in terms of, like, we could do what we love. What we love to do is a job, but it's not a job because we love to do it. So, you know, like Riz says, keep on keeping on.
Keep on keeping on.
Right? But I got Dandino in the house. Can I get some shine on my boy Dandino?
Hey, this motherfucker always has a smile like a motherfucker.
Yeah.
And he comes always with a hug.
Yeah.
I love him.
See, he wants a hug. That's
yeah, there it is. Dandino, the hug. There's the hug right there. Yeah.
He always, I can't say what he says in my ear, but he always
asks me the right questions.
Hey, but check it out. Here. Dandino is a pimp player and a part-time dragon slayer.
Yeah.
I've been through 3 rodeos, 4 circuses. I ain't never seen no shit like this. That's some shit. Got to drop some of the 80s shit, right? You know. Scotty, what's up, Scotty? What's up, Sai,
oh,
my
where
boy?
Is he? Why didn't Sai show him? You got the knife?
10th Planet.
So, what do you train? Do you train with those guys? You know Sai?
I need. Yeah, yeah, I know Sai. Sai's my boy. What's up, Scotty? Love you, brother. Love you. You know what I mean? Yes, sir.
Energy, you know?
Yeah. Monster.
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 Rock the bell.
Orlando
hey,
here.
Hey, Dandino, let's get over here, bro. I gotta give a little shout out. Dandino, real quick.
What are we doing? What are we
got on? That motherfucking Estevan Oreo, Mr. Cartoon, Ruka. What's up, Pat?
Oh, Ruka.
Fucking Ruka all day, every day, the R.
We didn't talk about that.
What's up, Austin, all the boys, Perillo, everybody. Buchecha, Ruka.
Ruka, so we haven't talked about that. So
Pat's the man.
So Pat was the first dude to buy a third rail in Orange County.
Oh, shoot, Pat.
Yeah, before he had the line, he bought for like a thrift store.
Yeah, yeah.
And he saw third rail, he's like, this is the shit.
Yeah.
So he bought it, and then he went on to be Ruka, you know, like, but love Pat.
Yeah, I love Pat. Pat is a good human being.
Mm-hmm.
If I would aspire to be anybody, it would be Pat Tenori and Bruce Lee. And
damn,
that's that. Straight up.
That's big.
You know
what I mean? That's big.
That's big, man.
How's Pat doing?
Pat's always good, man.
Always good. Last time I ran into Pat, we're in Mammoth on a family thing. Yeah. And he was with his family, was with my family on the mountain. I ran into him. I was like, it was surreal.
He's a good dude all the way around. You know what I mean? I think we're a little too damaged. Coming up in the time we came.
We might be a little damaged. True talk, though. Fuck, man. I love this show. Like, there's certain things. Me and Dan were going to talk for 5 hours after the show about shit we can't talk about right now.
Yeah.
But, like, let's keep it positive.
Keep it positive.
Yeah. But, yeah, we might be a little damaged.
Maybe just a little bit. I mean, because if you went through the 80s and you're our age, it's like there got to be a little PTSD and a couple, you know, things wrong. But like I said, you know, like I said, his stuff is inspiring. Keep on keeping on. That's a mantra. Right?
And also,
people have said you guys need to do more shots.
Let's do one for Metallica. But Dandino has to be involved.
Dandino, get a glass.
Let's do this.
You know me. I need to move my hand so you can see the label when I'm pouring. Is that enough?
That's good.
That's enough.
That's dick.
That's an Eddie Donaldson shot, right? That's a grill. That's a Gorilla One shot. Where's Dandino's?
That's yours, right?
You gotta get another cup.
Let's get another cup.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, K2SWC.
Yeah,
sure.
What is this?
Yeah,
water?
Let's do it.
All right, so now I'm going to keep that canvas in.
Water? I'm going to do a WCA.
Yeah.
Let me get this shot real quick.
Was this water?
Yeah, that's yours, probably
bro,
not.
No, you're in. That's yours, go. That's yours. I'll get the shot. Go.
All right, here.
Go, big man.
Cheers.
Drink
cheers,
your double
cheers,
shot.
Cheers, very happy hour.
Family.
Drink your shot, bitch. My bad.
So I'm going to do the WCA. Huh? Much love.
Sorry, pal.
Hey, someone get the tattoo machine. Let's do this shit.
Let's do it. Get it.
Hey, Eddie, call Gabor. Get the tattoo machine.
Yeah.
We're giving each other tattoos. WCA K2S.
Yeah, it's going down. It's going down. Yeah.
Look at the smile. It's infectious. Give me a hug. He just smiles.
Dave One says, let's see your pen.
Can't control.
Who said that?
What's up, Dave? Love you, bro. It's all good. I got can't control. West Coast artists in the house.
This is gonna be on the canvas. I keep that means something to me.
Yeah.
So we have the K2S down here, like whatever.
There it is, bro. Yeah. Get this, that K2S in there.
Yeah. Shit just kind of happened. This is kind of real, but people.
What's up, Natalie? How you
it's
doing?
It's going to take a week for people to get like, what just happened?
As long as my boy Dan's here, I'm good. That's the security force right here. I'm good. As long as my boy Dan's here, all my friends are like, hey, bro. They're like, I feel like I know Dan already. Because like, it's like when you have three shots, you go live and you FaceTime Dan. That's two things you do. That's better than anything else.
Dan, I was like,
Dan Dino, West Grown, bro.
I just, Dan threw me off. So I just call him West Grown.
Yeah.
Yep. I'll wrap this up. You
want to
go ahead and just introduce everybody
yet,
real quick?
Let's do this.
Instagram.
LA. Hey,
Deffer
K2S at whatever the fuck.
Instagram. This is probably going to go for a minute, so we're probably going to go on and off because shit's going to get a little weird later.
Yeah.
So we'll be on and off.
Hey, Gabor said he's going to